Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Take the Studios Gaming News PowerUp Hour. We're here with gaming news from throughout the week, as little as it may be, before E3. Before E3, it's kind of died down. Not a lot of your bigger publishers even really worry about E3 that much. A lot of the news leaks out before then anyway, so they just kind of get ahead of it.
Man. My apologies.
That's fine. We're going to move on to the icebreakers.
Yeah, my name is Joshua Shoemaker.
My name is Spencer.
My name is Cody.
Him with his blonde hair now. You can see all of us every week on this show and or on our Pokken tournaments. As you'll see, all of us lose because none of us are the champion to our own championship.
Yeah.
But we're going to go ahead and seriously move on to the icebreakers. Basically, we just talk about what we've been playing recently, which for me, finished Far Harbor completely. There's nothing left to find or do there, and it was great. It was fantastic. It's almost like Obsidian stepped in and fixed Fallout. But after that, Plants vs. Zombies Garden Warfare 2 had a huge update for me to sit through so it could download, and it was actually pretty awesome sometimes. There's a new map on there. There's a lot of new unlockables for customization, which are cool. I like the customization aspects, even though I usually just go for the characters sometimes. Like now, there's so many customization options. I'll just go for the customization options. I have a favorite on every class. So the new map is huge and very detail-oriented. There's a lot of stuff going on. There's an arcade at one point. There's a part where you can disco dance. It's really weird. But that game is fantastic. I love it, and you're watching some of it right now.
Cool.
Josh, what have you been playing lately?
Fallout 4, same stuff. Hasn't changed in since November. Yeah, all right. Cody, what have you been playing?
Good God.
The Stalker series. It's like Fallout 4, kind of, but less disappointing.
Oh, man. What? That's the stuff based on the Chernobyl incident, right?
Right, yeah.
I know what the word is.
Yeah. Chernobyl.
Chernobyl incident.
Yeah.
How's that game like? It's a little bit older.
Yeah, it's the one I'm on is from like 2008, but
that's super old.
Yeah.
There are kids right now playing Call of Duty and beating me, and they were born after 2008.
Yeah, I know. It's incredible. It's weird, but like, no, I like them a lot. I actually like them more than I liked Fallout 3, which is saying a lot.
Neat side note: the people that made Stalker series started a Kickstarter to scam you out your money. And it was proven, and they admitted to it, and they were like, we're really sorry. Here, we're done. We're leaving forever.
What?
Yeah.
But now some of the developer team is, like, making a new, like, almost photorealistic shooter, kind of in the same vein. I mean, it's very Russian.
It's the same people that tried to rip us off of our money.
Right.
They're just not going through a Kickstarter this time.
Yeah.
So what they're going to do is they're going to have all these trailers, they're going to buy the game, and there's going to be nothing. It's going to be a text document that basically just says, ha, we got you this time.
Or, best case scenario, it could be similar to Stalker, which we could definitely use another one of those for sure.
Well, just play Fallout 3. Play the 18.
No.
Fallout 4 mods on Xbox One are 50 times more used than on PC. Now, you'll see that article floating around. You'll see that title, that headline being shared on Facebook by people that don't know anything.
Because how exactly...
Which adds all Facebook posts that are shared.
Yeah. And you know, YouTube commenters.
Yes.
How exactly are they getting those statistics anyway?
I think they're getting the statistics... Well, I think Bethesda's a little butthurt. Let's just... Mm-hmm. I love Bethesda. Really do. They're in my top three favorite game developers out there. There's Nintendo, there's Rockstar Games, and there's Bethesda. If you couldn't tell by the subjects that we choose every week. Stop being weird to the camera, Josh. Okay. For audio format people, he's staring lovingly or rapingly into the camera. Wearing a punk Jews t-shirt.
Yep, I'm not an anti-Semite.
Sending the right message here. But anyway, Bethesda mods. That's what it is. It's Bethesda mods. Now, those of us that play on PC, hashtag PC Master Race, with a punk Jews shirt on, Master Race, crap. We're good with words.
Yay.
We use Nexus mods. Why would we use the Bethesda-approved mods when we can have Nexus mods?
Yeah, gross.
You have to jump through a lot of hoops to get the mods approved by Bethesda, and those can be put up or taken down depending on what they do, and they can't really alter real stuff in the game. Like, they can't go in there, and if you have to alter code, they don't have anything to do with that kind of stuff. It's purely, you know, easy install is what the Bethesda mods are. Nexus mods, no. Nexus mods, you have your easy install mods, and you have your mods that completely change the game. And Xbox One, they don't have that option of Nexus mods. It's running on Xbox One. If it was in the PC market, it'd be a low-end PC. It'd be a $200 to $300 PC. That's what it would be, power-wise. I have an Xbox One. I love it for what it is. I got it to play with people online, but I did not buy it for the power, as most people don't buy their consoles for the power. If they do, then they don't know what power truly is. But Nexus mods versus the Bethesda mods. I know it's one you would choose, but how different is it? Is it a 50-to-1 shot on the PC side using Nexus compared to Bethesda mods?
What do you mean 50-to-1 shot?
Say this right here, 50 times more used on Xbox One than PC. Even if their numbers are accurate, how do you think it is in the PC community? Do you think anyone's using these Bethesda mods on the PC?
God, no. First off, there are a few really good ones that are on the Bethesda mods.
Yes.
But they're already on Nexus. Everyone already has them.
Yes, that's true. That's true. It took a long time to get on Bethesda.
There are no restrictions. Pretty much no restrictions. Actually, no restrictions for Nexus mods.
True.
It's easy install. They have their installer. It's a one-click thing. And all these customization options for these really in-depth mods. Yeah. I haven't tried using any complex mods on the Bethesda mods that have some of the different features when you're installing. I don't even know if they can do that. Like, for a simple example, the Darker Night mods. You have all the different selections of how dark you want it, how yes. much you want the sneak to change with detection. I haven't installed that on the Bethesda mods, obviously, because I have it through Nexus. But I don't know if you can have those customization installation options.
That's the big thing. Is the fact that you are sacrificing with the Xbox One mods. Now, it's great that they have mods. It really is not... I'm not anti-mod. It really makes a lot of sense that they started doing this. Even if it was delayed, I think this would have been much better at launch, or at least a couple months after launch. It being this far away, I think it kind of hurts the momentum it had at one point. I think PS4 may not ever be able to do it. So there's a lot of things going on. There's a lot of things at play. But... the PC mods are always going to be superior, not to play that Master Race card, but you're going to have those issues with the Xbox One. Those issues are the limitations. There's also a limit on the space.
You can only have 2 gigabytes worth of mods installed at a time.
Yeah.
But one really cool feature with the Bethesda mods is that when you install them, and if it corrupts your game because it's not perfectly regulated, if it messes up too much your game, it's going to create a new save once you install the mod. So if that messes something up, you can automatically revert back hassle-free to when it was working without that mod.
True. Very, very, very true. So if you're already 200 hours in to your Xbox One Fallout play, good. I'm good to go. But when I install it, and it's like, oh, now it's crashing everything. All right, let me bring it back down. Now, the PS4 mod thing is a problem I've seen with a couple of Bethesda things. Bethesda just released a patch that fixes Far Harbor on PS4. Xbox One, like I said, I explored everything. And I go out, I nuked everything. I mean, you got a few legendary creatures on there. I'm at almost a level 100, and there's some legendary creatures on there that are scaled to be ahead of me. So I had to use a lot of nukes on them. I never had frame rate drops, much less freezing and stuff. PS4 had to have a huge patch that you had to go in and manually download to overwrite part of the game that's saved onto your PS4. Now, does that mean that PS4 was supposed to be an easier infrastructure than PS3 was to really go about things, but how much is it going to prove for developers that developing for Xbox One will be easier because of its link with Windows, Windows 10, all that kind of, unity between everything Windows? You think that's going to play a factor in things in the future?
Well, obviously, you don't want to be as much of a hassle to developers as you already are. Nintendo already had that problem with, they just didn't work very well with anyone.
Yeah, but PS4 has double the install base that Xbox One has. Is it kind of a risk-reward thing?
Yeah, I guess.
Putting out there some... Whatever, Josh. You with your Cody, how do you feel about it? Are you excited for mods?
Kind of. I'd much rather have a stronger PC, which I unfortunately can't afford right now.
But are you going to play them on the Xbox One?
I might. Really, all I want, and I haven't seen this, I was looking on Bethesda.net. I just want one good overhaul. I mean, it doesn't have to be graphics, but like perks and new weapons and armor and just one solid overhaul mod.
Yeah.
And that's all I care about.
What if Bethesda just came out with that as their last batch of big-time DLC?
I'd be fine with that. Just
almost like Gunrunner Arsenal, but times 10.
Maybe times 20. Even. Like, just tons of... That's what I'd hear about in most games is, you know, content-wise.
Weapon selection.
Weapon selection, armor
and perks
selection.
Would be great. Yeah. Adding some more perks. I'd have to draw, like, crude animations onto my poster I got with my Fallout. Yeah. But, I mean, yeah, that'd be great. Also, on my PC, I have crossbows because I needed that perk. I needed more weapons. So that'd be great if someone could release some cool...
I hate that you installed crossbows because we share the gaming PC. He comes down here and plays on it. And I don't like that crossbows are in my world. I don't. I'm not going to install it because I know it's going to mess with his. And he may not know I've, turned it off and then ruin his file. So I just have to deal with it because I'm not a jerk like he is.
It's so good.
Installing terrible mods.
Okay. Next up.
I was just walking into this quarry, and then Piper lights on fire for some reason, and then there's someone shooting fire arrows up at her, and bolts. I didn't know, where did this come from?
Bolts. It came from...
Bolts, whatever. Fire arrows, I was making a Zelda reference.
Bolts.
Yeah, I was about to make a Zelda reference. It came from the goddess Helia, but I was probably... Whatever. From a game that sold incredibly well to another game that sold incredibly well, but with a much smaller budget. Psyonix, hit game Rocket League, has made $110 million from a $2 million budget. Man, that's awesome. I love it when indies really do this. I mean, I know Minecraft is downloaded like, 46,000 times a day. And I know Shovel Knight sold a huge amount, thanks to a Kickstarter. And I'm sure Ukulele, when it comes out, it will sell millions. But to make this $110 million... for an indie game, that's incredible. They make it off of DLC. They make it off of the sales of the games. It's more Americans like car soccer than actual soccer, and that's pretty incredible to accomplish that feat.
We're so cultured here.
We are so cultured here. Video games unite. Have you guys tried Rocket League? What do you guys hear about Rocket League or like about Rocket League?
I was actually on Xbox Live with a friend of mine the other night. And, you know, I tried to help him with his first Dark Souls playthrough, and that didn't work, but he was talking about,
he gave
up. You need to get Rocket League. No, we just couldn't connect.
Okay, okay.
But, he was talking about, you need to get Rocket League, you need to play this with me. And just about everyone I know really plays Rocket League.
Demons don't come out of the walls and kill you in Rocket League, even though with all their tie-ins, I'm sure they'll work that in eventually. I mean, they had the Warthog from Halo. They had the Batmobile and the Superman Mobile when BVS came out. Yeah.
Be nice, a Bonfire Mobile.
A Bonfire Mobile?
Mm-hmm.
Because BVS was a bonfire? What are you talking about?
No, I'm talking about... You were talking about...
Oh, Dark Souls. Dark Souls. Dark Souls.
The tie-ins, yeah.
Mm.
Yeah.
Also, when the March Madness was going on with NCAA basketball, for those of you that know what sports are, they had a basketball version of... What? Why are you being so weird? They had a basketball version of Rocket League pop up. I think it's a fun game. It's really cool. This last Humble Monthly, they gave you Rocket League just for subscribing, which was really neat. I don't think it's still going, but that was really cool. They have sales on it all the time on Steam. I know Xbox One and PS4, they can get it, and it's cool that consoles can get that, but it really was an indie darling that... Usually, your indie games launch on Steam and become big hits and then come to consoles like Ark. Mm-hmm. And this is another one. It's just... They're funding $2 million. That's more than a lot of people get to really refine a game. They got to build a team that was better and bigger than a lot of indie games get. But $110 is still a big chunk of change.
Mm-hmm.
Big return on investment. It's almost like them going into BVS with their tie-in. It's almost ironic that Warner Brothers, who doesn't know how to get a return on investment, teams with Rocket League. On from one great game to another great game, and now another great game, because we only talk about great games on here sometimes, except for Ninja Turtles. The CEO of Take-Two Studios came out and he said that VR was overpriced, too expensive, and just did not, it demanded too much, and it was just not realistic for real-world people. Do you guys agree with this? Because he was talking about, he was referring to the cost of entry. Mm-hmm. So say with a PlayStation VR, that's hundreds of dollars for a headset. And that's just the nice estimates people have. Because you're looking at, you have the games you have to buy that work for it. And it's not like they work on both PS4 and VR. It's just the PlayStation VR. And then you've got the Oculus, which you have to buy. That's hundreds of dollars. And then you need a PC that can run the Oculus. Now, mind you, you have a lot more games that can work, and people mod games like Fallout 4 to work with Oculus, so that's not a big deal. You're not limited with the games, but for the most part, especially if you buy the PlayStation VR, you're buying something that's more just a gimmick. It's almost like the Wii Balance Board, but way more expensive.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to have a room dedicated to it. You have to have a whole room. Make sure you don't have a toddler child that can walk up behind you and you knock them in the head and give them a concussion. Then DHR comes and takes your babies away. That's what I feel like VR is going to do. Make everyone's babies get taken away.
Yeah.
But how do you guys feel about what the Take-Two boss said? Because if anyone knows games, it's those guys. Take-Two Studios, also Rockstar.
Well, everything that he said is logical. That's just not something normal people can do that they can afford.
Is there anything that has piqued your interest about VR that would lean you to, like, maybe I'll spend $500 on this?
Not VR, no. Like, AR is cool. Like,
augmented reality?
Yeah, but not VR. That just seems more annoying just to have this thing. I'm still using a controller or a mouse and keyboard. That's not going to make it feel more immersive.
Or the Move with the PlayStation VR.
I'm not doing that.
Mm. You're like one of those ravers at a club. That's pretty sweet. Cody, do you have anything VR in the VR wheelhouse that intrigues you?
Not at this point, but I'm open to the idea of something coming along and me being like, you know, that's cool. I want to get my hands on that. Like, it could happen.
Yeah.
We'll just have to wait and see.
I feel like it could happen, but I mean, it's almost just like a change of perspective. It's like, I wasn't sold on a Nintendo 3DS because of the 3D on there. It was the next console. It wasn't a side, you know, kind of benefit. It was like, this is the next console. Whether I like 3D or not, I need to get it to play the Nintendo games, because the only way I can get a decent portable gaming experience is through Nintendo. It's not through PlayStation or phones, iOS. And that's why I got it. Not because of the 3D. The aspect of what I'm viewing doesn't change the way I'm going to play the game. Just because you're putting it around my eyes doesn't make it any different. I'm going to play that game regardless if the game looks good. I'm not going to play the game if it's cool, if I can turn my head and something scares me. That's dumb. I don't understand that. Like, they have those experiences in an arcade, but it's 3 minutes and you spend a dollar on it. Like, it's way different. Like, Okay, that's the point of that. Augmented reality, let's just touch on that real quick. So PlayStation and, of course, Oculus/Facebook has really pushed the VR realm. Who do you see pushing the AR realm, augmented reality? If Pokemon Go comes out on iOS this year, that's augmented reality mixed with portable gaming that everyone loves, which is Pokemon. What augmented reality are you talking about that you're intrigued by, that you would spend hundreds of dollars on?
The Microsoft HoloLens. I've talked about it, like, all the time. Almost every episode we have, I've tried to talk about it in some way. Forever. Not just for gaming purposes. Actually, that's not even the main reason that I, you know, want a HoloLens. Not for playing the games, because it's not going to be a gaming powerhouse on your head. It's just not. It's a full computer, and so it being on your head isn't going to be very strong. It's going to be probably as strong as your phone.
That is a good point. I didn't think about the power the VR could have if it's not... Now, if it's not something that's heavy on your head, like, you know, there's a box that sends a signal to the headset, and then you have your own limitations that way. We've seen those limitations. The speeds of Bluetooth response time compared to, like, video streaming to a device, which would mean even if you have a box with a VR being sent to it, there will be a delay. No way you can really fight that.
What Nintendo developed for the Wii U is... you can't notice any kind of difference, but that is a proprietary piece of hardware.
True.
And so that the other systems that are going to use any kind of VR are going to have to do the same thing. Right. Because Bluetooth is not quick enough. Definitely not going through a wireless network is quick enough.
And I commend the Take-Two boss for knowing what real people are like, because he pays regular wages to a lot of the developers, and he actually made the statement that the people I know, the people that work here, are normal people, and they don't have a room that they can dedicate to a gaming space. They have a room they can dedicate to a TV, to a couch, to a coffee table, to a gaming console. And it's a living room, and that's what a lot of people have. A lot of people have downsized, and you get negative point for not turning that on silent.
Okay, well, it was a message from YouTube, so does that count?
Nope. Okay. To people that think that we are super dumb, like the dumbest people, the EA, oh man, the EA developers, before the EA people that make decisions on the games, before they decided Battlefield 1 could be done, they were worried that we have a generation of really, really, really dumb people, and that we wouldn't know that the Vietnam War was a thing, World War II was a thing, and much less World War I was a thing. They really thought that we didn't know that America had been at war besides over in the Afghani and Iraqi deserts.
And remember that their games are rated M for mature, which means 17 is the minimum age to play their games.
So how bad is the American public school system? We know it's bad. But is it so bad that we don't know that there was a war and what may have caused that war? I don't believe that. Okay, so here's a test. Do either one of you know what country started World War One?
It was Nazi Japan, correct?
Nazi Japan. That's so close. Cody. Right.
It was Canada.
This is why. Yeah. EA was right. Oh my God. Oh my God. So, I really have a problem that they didn't think that Americans, or just that the youth in general, would know that any of these wars existed. But World War One was so important. And World War Two is the most famous war, correct? Yes. Answer is yes.
Yeah.
The Nazis.
Nazi Japan.
Nazi Germany. Hitler. That's what I mean. All of these things. Like, Captain America fought in World War II. That was a big time movie. The whole basis of his character, the most popular character in movies right now, is the fact that he was frozen during World War II while he was fighting the Nazis. Why would they think that we wouldn't know that World War I existed? How do you get World War II? It's a sequel. Like, the only way you get sequels is that there was one first. This isn't the Terminator, where you just mess up all the timelines. You don't know which one came first. George Lucas didn't write this war. There was a standard. There was World War One, then World War Two. We didn't have to do prequels. You didn't start with Episode Four and move on and then go back. This is how wars work. They thought that we didn't know World War One was a thing. I'm almost so offended that they thought I was that dumb that I wouldn't. Not even just me, but that people in general are that dumb. No, that I may not buy the game.
I mean, I don't know anyone personally that is actually that stupid, but there might be those kinds of people in the world.
There are, Cody?
There are.
Explain to us, since you dyed your hair to match the Third Reich. Go ahead.
Okay, that's a low blow. Well, I mean, for example, I went to school with a girl who, she didn't know who Hitler was. Like, someone made a comment in passing about Hitler calling someone Hitler, and she goes, "Who's Hitler?" And we were like,
"Who's Hitler?"
And we were like, "What?" And she was like, "Who Hitler?" We were like, "Hold on, you don't know who Hitler was?" So, I mean,
the only true evil.
And I was a senior at this point in time, so, like, that's...
So, this is the... That was the age group that would be buying
a
mature game.
That's really frustrating to know that happens in real life. I wonder what kind of games or who they're catering their games to if they think that the youth wouldn't know what World War One is. Now, gamers have moved on. Like, you have your youth gamers, you always will. But your gamers that go out and actively buy games are going to be in that 25 to 35 male demographic. That's the most demographic you're going to get, despite what you may think. Oh, inclusion, that's just how it is. That's numbers. You can't fight facts. That's who buys the majority of the games. So you think that the 25 to 35 year olds don't know what World War One is, or you're catering these games, these shooters that Call of Duty's been catered to for years, to babies, to 7-year-olds, to this generation of people that will be allowed to vote in this next election that don't remember 9/11. So they're not catering the games to me, is how I feel about it. They went ahead with this, thinking that people wouldn't know what this war is, and they didn't care. Also brings the, some people are under the assumption that this is a work of fiction, that this is an alternate timeline. I guess it very well could be if they think we wouldn't know any better anyway. Very, very frustrating. And weird. How are you going to end this game? You're just going to like be an American soldier that's blocking a shipment of food and just scream. You're going to press buttons for quick time events to scream at Germans. You're going to starve! Like, that's how they gave up. Germany gave up because they were done starving.
Well, you know, now that you say that, like, that wouldn't really be a bad way to end the game. It'd be entertaining, like, starve!
I don't know if that'd be entertaining.
That would all be. Sudden, I would love it. That'd be hilarious.
This generation of people that don't know that this war even happened would then be under the assumption that we were the evil ones.
That we that planned. That would fill me with American pride. Like, I don't want that.
No, we were so peaceful. We waited. We waited and waited until Mexico and Germany had a deal on the table until that they would invade us. I mean, we did. Okay, we shipped guns to the other countries. Through hidden boats until Germany started sinking all of our boats. And then we're like, we're going to hide these guns on civilian ships. And then Germany just decided that any American ships were going to sink. And then we were like, all right, well, we're out. Then Germany's like, Mexico, you wanna have a party? You know, up there? Create a little Cinco de Mayo. A fiesta. Think of that Spanish word for party. And then America said, you know what? F this. Then America entered the war, and then we won. As all wars happen.
USA.
I'm too young to know that Vietnam and Korea happened, so all I know is victory. Yeah. from altering history to altering the future. You like that?
What? No.
All right. No one likes it. Nintendo's E3 plans, because E3 is in the future, so is the NX. It's their whole future.
Gotcha. Okay.
Oh, man. Nintendo has come out with their Nintendo Direct plans, also their live presentation. Nintendo before had said they were going to do an all-day playthrough from the Nintendo Treehouse of Zelda, which basically means we would have watched the whole game play out.
Or not. Maybe there's a lot of content to it.
Don't think there is.
I think so. I'm going to have hope.
You can have hope. I will have hope. I would have more hope in this game if it didn't come to the Wii U, which they're not showing any NX version of anything at E3. I just wish they'd skip the Wii U.
Yeah.
I mean, it's going to do nothing to hold you back. I'm sorry for the people that bought it, but if you bought it at launch like we did, or if you bought it and you're cool with playing a backlog of games, like a lot of people talk about, oh, this doesn't have enough games, and then when they buy it, they never go back and play the old games. The Wii U has tons of great games that are exclusive. It's not like I could have played this on PC. They're exclusive. They're exclusive. You can only play on Wii U. It had plenty of games. This could skip, and I would not be mad. But they have shown that they're going to show a bunch of 3DS games and Wii U games. Bunch, I mean a couple. Mm. But they're going to show some of that.
Some Mario, is that right? Some Kirby. One of them.
They
maybe a Star Fox, like half a Star Fox.
Those have all already come out. I don't know what you're doing with your life right now.
Yeah, well, what else they got?
Well, Monster Hunter is going to be coming out
Monster
soon.
Hunter Generations, okay. Man. That's what they're going to show.
Out in, I think, July? Yeah. Maybe late June, something like that.
Super Paper Mario for the Wii U. Yeah, Paper Mario. Okay, you said Mario. Yeah. Okay, that counts, I guess. Tokyo.
They make like 1,000 Kirby games a month, so.
Tokyo Mirage Sessions. Tokyo Mirage Sessions.
Tokyo Massage Sessions?
Mirage. Tokyo Mirage Sessions. It's basically
Nintendo did used Fire to be Emblem a love hotel, so
yeah, I mean it's Fire Emblem mixed with an anime. It may be good, it may be terrible. Nintendo used to be a love
hotel, because the Tokyo massage sessions. That's so
that really
that's
great
too
name
adult
for
Nintendo.
They used to be a love hotel.
So, I mean they can judge all they want. They ran a cab service.
Yeah.
But
they have a weird history. We made playing cards for the Royal Dynasty family. Then we were a taxi company. Then a love hotel. Let's make video games.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, logical. Logical steps in their history. Yeah. Their history is limited, though, if they keep making bad mistakes. I believe that this whole E3 now covering more games that come out this year is really... And Pokemon Sun and Moon was always going to sell 15 million copies. I mean, no one's doubting that. It may sell more because Omega Ruby Alpha Sapphire were terrible and they still sold a whole bunch. But this game is going to sell a whole bunch. Now, I feel like that they pushed this forward, pushed the whole... Here's our whole lineup agenda because of news that has broke out that they are pushing production of their NX by about a year. It was supposed to start going into mass production right now. All of their parts are being made and produced and all that, but they're not being assembled yet. They're not being assembled till 2017. Mind you, their console was supposed to launch April 2017 along with Zelda.
Wait, so all of their hardware has actually been made, they're just not assembling?
Yes.
Why?
Because they are wanting to debate, they're wanting to internally debate the status of their portables and VR.
Well, screw the VR, I don't know why they want to do that. But if they already have all the hardware made, just not assembled, then this time that they're wasting, they're not going to be advancing the tech.
They may change the tech.
Well, hopefully.
To introduce VR, but they've got a lot of the parts made. So it basically just means how they would, I guess, reassemble it.
No.
I really don't understand exactly their planning. Because, first off, why would you jump into VR? Why would you jump into VR? I get making a bigger memory on the device, more processing speed, and USB ports to attach something to use VR later that can attach to it. But even Sony couldn't do that. Even Sony couldn't have the PSVR work with the PS4. So you'd have to make great strides to make that happen. And this should have been settled. The NX should have been the replacement for the 3DS and the Wii U. That should have already been in the bag. The fact that they're debating this means that maybe they're out of touch with what the market needs and wants out of them. But, yeah. I think that's why they are pushing all their games out now with it in Nintendo Direct. It's like, hey, we do have games. Don't give up because we're going to be about 6 months late to the party like we said we would.
Yeah.
Because it's probably going to launch, if they're really not putting it together until 2017, they won't launch until October, November.
Man.
Yeah. Which means we're probably getting Zelda Wii U on Wii U in April, or they'll push it back to launch on NX.
I'd rather than push it back. I don't even want to see it on Wii U.
I'd rather than push it back, but this is going to be 2 years without any actual effort from Nintendo. Feels like the Wii all over again.
Yeah.
Because the Wii started strong, had a few great years. In the last 2 years, let's just give up. Let's move towards this tablet.
I think that's their legacy.
Is giving up. 3 years strong, give up. They're the Cleveland Cavaliers. Nintendo's the Cleveland Cavaliers. Let's put in three quarters, but then that last quarter, we'll just give up. Golden State can have this.
Cleveland show?
You could almost think
sports.
You could almost think that Nintendo were a French company.
Oh. Because
they go in strong and then give up.
Oh. We would like to thank you for watching our Gaming News Power-Up Hour, brought to you by Take This Studios. My name is Spencer. You can find me on social networking everywhere at Psycho1316, SYCO1316.
And I'm Joshua Shoemaker. On Twitter, you can find me at JShoemakerDev and Instagram at Joshua_Shoemaker.
And I am Cody Coggins, and you can find me on Twitter at BilboCoggins.
BilboCoggins. And collectively, you can find us at Take This Studios, also on every social networking site. And if you head over to our other videos on YouTube, we have a Pokken tournament going on that will finish up within a week. Then we have the DC Injustice Loser tournament going on. Cody still going strong in the Pokken tournament. Josh and me are not. Wow. Yeah, we're done, as always. Shoemakers bring us on to the family. But the tournaments we do are always for charity. Nintendo's going to take that money regardless because we're using their games. But we do it to spread awareness for charity. So if you would spread awareness to our videos, which also spreads awareness to charity, we kind of benefit ourselves that way.
Yeah, PR.
Yeah. Thank you, and we will see you next week.
Bye.
Goodbye.
Thank you.